going to do our foundational text. So, Miss Michelle, you know, I've been this is my 11th lesson on the Gospel of John. And so, what is the foundational text? The first one that I always have you guys quote. What's the first one? Anybody remember besides Michelle? Nobody remembers? I know I teach sporadically. What is it? Who said it? Isaiah. I was laughing when you were about that scripture in prayer and healing. I'm having a ball over there to myself. I'm going, she's saying now, okay, where's this? We quote this every time I teach. So we're going to quote it again because by the time I finish John, which I don't know when, but by the time I finish, you should know Isaiah 9:6 by memory. Amen. So let's say it together. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulder, and we shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Praise the Lord. So the Holy Spirit had you bring that that particular scripture. So he is the Prince of Shalom. He is the Prince of Peace. He is God manifested in the flesh. And that's what, now we're going to read our second foundational text for this particular lesson is found in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. So if you will turn there, please. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, and we'll read together in unison. Were you able to get her? No? Okay. He says here in verse 16, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. What's that mystery that's been revealed now? God, what? Was manifest in the flesh. He was made apparent in the flesh. He was justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. So the Bible lets us know very pointedly that this is without controversy. This is without arguing. This is without debate. We don't get into a debate about Jesus being God manifested in the flesh. You either believe it or you don't. So he says, this is without controversy, without debate, without conflict. God was manifested in the flesh. And when we start teaching on the book of John, this is what John does. He points out his whole thing has to do with the deity of Jesus Christ. And that's what he's pointing out here really in his entire scripture. Let's go to the Gospel of John. And I left off, which had gotten into starting at the beginning of chapter 11. And so we're going to go to the Gospel of John starting at, we finish up chapter 10 last week. And so we're going to start with John chapter 11. Are you there? Almost, okay. And so we covered a lot of scriptures and don't have time. I'm not going to go back over those. You can read them. We read from 1 through 11. So we're going to pick up. Actually, I stopped at verse 8, according to my notes here. All right, so we're going to read, start at 7 and 8 for continuity's sake. We know that here Lazarus had been attacked with a sickness, and he had gotten word that Lazarus had been it was sick. And so let me do verse 4. It says, when Jesus heard that he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, the Son of God might be glorified thereby. So here the scripture is saying that Jesus already declared, he said, this sickness is not unto death. So he's already made his declaration. He says, and as a result of this, he says, the glory of God will be manifested, and that way, as God's glory is manifested, it will be manifested in the Son of God. Verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Why do you think he abode 2 days there? Why? Because he had already declared that the sickness was not what? So he knew that Lazarus, well, what? It was going to live. So he says here in verse 7, then after that saith he to his disciples, let us go unto Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, they're getting real concerned here. Because they attempted to kill Jesus before when he was in Judea. So he says, you see how, just put a plug in here, you see how these religious people, these religious Jews back then, they tried on several occasions to kill Jesus. That's why religion doesn't work. Religion will kill you. Those who practice religion will kill you. I mean, we're seeing this evidence right now here all over the world in the Middle East. Everything is based on their belief system, their religion. And the same thing was happening here in Jesus' day. Because they disagreed with him, they want to wipe him out. Do you know that spirit is still pervading today? Here, even America, we're not getting physically ill, but with the mouth, they're tearing, ripping Christians apart. They're killing us with their mouth. When I say killing us, saying things in a very negative way about Christianity, comparing us with ISIS. We're no better than ISIS. I mean, there's a lot of junk that they're saying about us. Oh, yeah, it's out there. The freedom from religion. You know who the freedom from religion group is? The atheists, that's their group. And so they're out there saying a lot of crazy stuff. So like Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun. They were doing these centuries ago when Jesus walked to earth. So verse 8, he says, and his disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Did you know that they were trying to kill you? So why are you going to go back to the same place where they were trying to kill you? But Jesus was on what? He was on purpose. He was on his purpose. And he knew when his time would be up. Because remember we read back in chapter 10, he says what? Nobody does what? Take his life. What does he do? He gives it up freely. They couldn't kill him. Why? He said, what's his name? The governor at that time, when Jesus wouldn't say anything, and Pilate. And he said, don't you know I have the power to set you free or to kill you? And he says, you don't have any power or authority over me. Verse 9, Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not. Because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth because there is no light in him. Verse 11. These things said he, and after that he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth. But I go that I may awake him out of his sleep. Now, when Jesus said that Lazarus was asleep, they actually thought he was actually sleeping. And Jesus was saying that Lazarus was dead. And so that was a term that they would use in the Old Testament, or even in the book of Acts, and we're going to turn there in a minute, when he said Lazarus sleepeth. In the Bible, a lot of times the word death is often referred to as sleep. And what that is really, it's our body that's sleeping, and only believers' bodies sleep. The death of the saint is a restful sleep from the problems of the world. But when we leave this body, when we dismiss our spirits, we immediately go to be with the Lord. But the body is in a state of repose until Jesus come back and we get our glorified bodies. But the Bible says that they were asleep. And let's look at Genesis. Keep your finger there. Let's look at Genesis 47, verse 30. You see what I'm saying here, how they used to use this term. In Genesis, when 47. Genesis 47, and we're going to look at verse 30. Jacob here blesses Joseph's sons, and so he's telling Joseph that when they get ready to leave Egypt to carry out, he does not want to be buried in Egypt. He wants to be buried in the burying place where his father. So he says, but I will lie with my fathers. And that's talking about I will be buried. I will die where my fathers are. And thou shalt carry me out of Egypt and bury me in their burying place. And he said, I will do as thou hast said. And so Joseph said, well, I will honor that. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 27. We're dealing with this where it says death, where Lazarus sleepeth. Look at Matthew chapter 27, verse 52. We're looking at how they use this term for death, and that means death of the body. Chapter 27, and we're going to look at verse 52. Are you there? Okay, let me get there. I'm still in 26 here. 27. All right. He says here in verse 52, and the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept, arose. That's during the time when Jesus was resurrected, other graves came. And so when I was reading this there, and I believe that it's true, my commentary here, these were the people that came up out of the graves, and their bodies had been asleep all this time into paradise. And I believe that it's true because the scripture really bear out. It says, and the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose. Now, you remember the scriptures in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. It says, he, Jesus, led what? Captivity what? Those were the Old Testament saints that when he came up, he brought them up out of paradise, because paradise was the place that they went in the Old Testament before Jesus ascended and was resurrected and went to heaven to be with the Father. So in Ephesians, he says, and he gave gifts unto men, and he led captivity captive. In other words, all those Old Testament saints who were looking forward to the coming Messiah, as it had been prophesied by all the prophets, Moses, everybody after that, had prophesied by the Messiah, about the Messiah coming, it was counted, just like with Abraham. Abraham, the Bible says, Abraham rejoiced to see this day. What? That he was also looking forward to the coming Messiah, because it had been prophesied throughout the Old Testament. And so, therefore, the Bible says that the Old Testament saints, it was also counted to them for righteousness because they believe what the Word of God says. And just like we read in Timothy, it talks about how it was a mystery, and what doesn't mean a mystery where you can't understand. It means that mystery of who the Messiah would be, that was the mystery. But now Jesus has come on the scene. He's been manifested, and the Bible says that he's God manifested in the flesh. So therefore, that mystery that was not revealed in the Old Testament now has been revealed in the New Testament. And so here, these saints, these Old Testament saints, they had their glorified bodies just like Jesus did, and they went up with him. All right, let's go to verse 12. Start at verse 12. Well, there was another one scripture I want to read. Go to Philippians before you go back to John. Let's go to Philippians chapter 1, verse 23. We're going to deal with this sleeping. Because there is a teaching, a doctrine where people think that when you die, you're not going to be conscious. You're just going to just like kind of be non-existence. But that's not true. Because your spirit and your soul are going to be very, very much alive, whether you're in heaven or whether you up in hell. For those who rejected the gospel of Jesus Christ, they will be separated. They're called what we call spiritually dead. What did I tell you to turn to? Philippians? Okay, Philippians chapter 1. And we're going to be reading verse 23. Thought that looked funny. Okay, in verse 23 it says, the writer says, "For I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." So here the Apostle Paul was saying, you know, I want to stay here because you need me, but I want to go and be with my Lord and my Savior. And I truly believe that when a loved one or a believer goes to be with the Lord, just as I had a friend, just saw her at our reunion a year ago in July. Looked like the picture of health. And she went to be with the Lord last month. It was just radical. But the thing is her sister said, she got a glimpse of glory. And the reason, you know, remember the Bible said death is an enemy? Death is an enemy. Death is not natural for us. And so the body just can't take it. And so when you get a glimpse of glory, you know, I mean, I haven't experienced this, but if you get a glimpse of glory and then your body is wrecked with pain and stuff, there's no way you want to come back to that body. And so, you know, she was under like total care. And I mean, it was just like rapid. It was like in May, July, she was a picture of health. And now, and my friend said that in May, you wouldn't even think it was anything wrong. And 2 months later, she's gone. And it was a rapid deterioration. But the point is that she and her brother, who's not necessarily a believer or pseudo, whatever, he made the statement, he said, she died with dignity. Now, she knew where she was going. His concept of it, she died with dignity. But she knew where she was gone. She was relaxed in the arms of Jesus. Amen. And that's the hope that we have, people. That's why with all this stuff that's going around with ICE, it doesn't matter about that. Why? Because we win either way you look at it. She won either way you look at it. Because she's out of that torturous body that, you know, was giving her such a hard time. And now she's with the Father. Amen. And so, you know, and then plus two, she was in her 70s, so she lived up to 70-something years, so praise the Lord for that. But death has no sting over the believer, because we do not cease to exist when our spirits depart our body, amen, we continue to live on. Let's look at another scripture. Let's look at 1 Thessalonians. This is one we read at a lot of times at memorial services, which is very good. I love this scripture. Back in 1990, it was very, very rhema for me when my father passed. And so, because he loved the Lord and he was a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so in verse 13, it says, Paul says, but I will not have, okay, I see here pages turning, so I'll wait. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. He says here, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are what? Asleep. And he's really talking about the body. Because once the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5, 8, to be absent from the what?
Body.
Is to be what?
Present with the Lord.
It's a transition. It's so quick. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So, like we just attended a memorial service, some of us on Sunday. So, that person at that, they weren't there. Even the body had been there. They weren't there. Why? Because their spirit and soul went to be immediately with the Lord whatever day they made their what? Their transition. So, when I saw my father's casket there, it didn't bother me. Why? Because of the fact that I knew that he was what? With the Lord. So I didn't try to pull him out the casket. You ever been to? Well, those of you know who've been to a background that, you know, a lot of that it was, you know, I won't make no comment on that, praise the Lord. But get all trying to get in the casket, sometimes I just say, close it on them. You know, I mean, it's just ridiculous, you know. But when you know what the word says, and so that's why I was so glad, because I wouldn't have tried to get in the castle with anybody before I knew this knowledge, you know, of being absent from the bodies to be present with the Lord. But I probably wouldn't have handled it as well as I did with the knowledge that I have. You know, so when a believer goes to be with the Lord, that's why we can rejoice. Now, sure, we're going to miss him. Sure, we did. I mean, my dad been gone over 20-some years. And I still think about those fond memories. You know, and you're supposed to think about fond memories. But not to the point where you can't function. That's not the grief that we're supposed to be involved in. That's the world's grief. Yes, we grieve, some longer than others, and that's okay because we all of us are made up differently, so we don't become judgmental based on how somebody else grieve. But we don't grieve the same way that the world grieves, amen? Because we have a hope, that confident expectation that we're going to see what that loved one again if they were in the Lord. And even like I have a couple of relatives, I'm not sure if they're with the Lord. I don't know if they made that transition. But everybody, they all had an opportunity to accept or reject the gospel. So I can't spend my time being concerned of what, you know, I wonder if they're in heaven. I don't know, because whatever choice they were here on earth, they made it. Are you hearing me? They made that choice. They made the choice not to receive Jesus. You know, you may have talked to him till you were blue in the face. But that's not your responsibility. It's not to make them get saved. It's just to present whenever you can. Amen?
Amen.
And God can't make anybody get saved. He says, it's not his desire that anybody perish. But that all come to repentance. So it's a free will involved. And so, You know, if you have a relative that you're not sure where they are, you know, just know this, that whatever, wherever they are, that's a decision that they made. And God gave them that right, just like he gave you and I that right. Amen? All right, so did I read 13? I went on that. Did I read 13 yet? I read it, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so we're going to move on to, let's go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 11. Gospel of John, we're on chapter 11. And so now we're going to read verses 12 and 13, and then I'll make some comments. So he says, then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. So what are they thinking? For them to make that statement, what are they thinking? Okay. They're thinking about he died what? Physically, right? They think that he's not dead. They're thinking that he's just what? He's sleeping. He's taking a nap. He's taking his afternoon nap. Okay, verse 13. He says, howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest in sleep. Verse 14, then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Jesus had to get real plain. And then in verse 15, he says, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent or the purpose that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. He says, I'm glad I wasn't there, because see, had he been there and Lazarus had died, say been dead for like 30 minutes, well, you know what the naysayer is going to say? What? What? He wasn't dead. You know, and they say that now. When people said they had an out-of-body experience, well, they weren't really dead anyway. No, they had an out-of-body experience. They were dead. So Lazarus was dead, but God said, okay, I'm going to show you that he was dead. And so he let him stay in the grave. How many days? All right, then verse 15, he says, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. So verse 16 says, then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may what? Die with him. Now, why would he say that? Ain't no good will, he didn't want to die with him. But because of what? Because of the previous history and what had happened to them previously when they were in Judea, they were apt to kill Jesus. So, you know, they're associating with Jesus, right? They're his disciples. So they figure if they're going to kill Jesus, they're going to kill us too. Because what? We're with him. So he said, well, let us go and die with him. Verse 17, then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave, how many days?
4 days
already. And the reason for 4 days, now Jesus only was in the grave how many days?
Three.
Because 3 days, in 3 days the body didn't corrupt. And the Bible says in the book of Psalms, that what? That his body would not, it was prophesied that Christ's body would not what? See corruption. The fourth day, though, the body has begun to what? To decompose. If you notice, if Jewish people as well as people from Islam, they will bury you, they try to bury you in 3 days. Because after the third day, the body begins to what? Decompose. And they have this thing about the body being decomposed. Well, the body going to decompose eventually anyway. Even when you get in the grave, it's going to be decomposed. But, you know, that's their belief. I'm not putting it down. So he says here in verse 18, he says, now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem about 15 furlongs off. That's about approximately about two miles from where they were. And so in verse 19, it says, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was still in the house. This is the same Mary and Martha. And he says in verse 21, then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou had been here, my brother had not died. So why would she say he would not have died? Because what? Because they had seen Jesus what? Going about healing all that were what? Oppressed of the devil, because God was with him. He went about casting out demons. So they were very accustomed to Jesus' ministry. And that's why she said what she said. And so in verse 22, he says, but I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. So she knew that Jesus got his prayers answered. Are you that confident in your prayers? He says in verse 23, Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Now 24, Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So she's talking about what? On the resurrection day. But Jesus come back and tell her what? Gloria, I love this. What did he say?
I am
the resurrection and the life. He that believeth, have confidence, commit to, trust in me, though he were dead, yet shall he what?
Live.
When there was a teaching going around years ago called, I don't know if you guys have heard of this, called the Never Die Movement. How many of you heard of that? And see, what they didn't understand, and those people, and I knew a couple that practiced that doctrine, and of course they're dead today. Because what? Because they didn't understand about death. There are two types of death. There's the spiritual death, which is what? What does spiritual death mean? Alienated and separated from the life and nature of God. And then there's the physical death. So here, they took out of context when the Bible says that they wouldn't see death. They were thinking about a physical death. And the Bible was talking about what? A spiritual death. That if they confess, acknowledge, and proclaim and accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, what? They would never, never, ever, what, die. But they wouldn't die spiritually. Amen? All right. So I want you to keep your finger there, and I want you to turn to, we'll come back to that. Jesus, we're on this, our fifth I am statement. How many I am statements are there? Come on, I heard the correct answer. Come on, somebody say it so the rest can hear it. How many?
Seven.
There are seven I am statements, and we are on the fifth one. What was the first one that we covered? I am the what? I am the light. I am the bread. The light. What else? I am the door. I am the good shepherd. And I am the resurrection and the life. And so here, we're going to look at, go to Numbers chapter 17. I want to point something out in the Old Testament where Aaron's rod that budded was a type of Christ in resurrection. So I want you to go to the book of Numbers chapter 17. And I want to point out some things there with you. Numbers chapter 17. And what I'm going to do now, because of I want to have some continuity where you can get an understanding of chapter 17. I'm going to give you a little background on 16, going to highlight some things for you. It's too much to read, so I'm just going to do a little highlighting here. So when we see here in the Old Testament, types and shadows, you know, I handed that out to you when I first started teaching on this particular subject. And so here in verse 16, Numbers 16, there was a group that was, Aaron was the what? First what?
Priest.
high priest of Israel. And so all of the priestly duties came through Aaron and his sons. And so what happened here is when Moses was leading the children of Israel, and Moses was a great leader, he was a very humble man. And so we had this group, and they were called, let me see what their names were. Who can tell me what their names were? Korah, remember Korah? So this group, it's just like with today. People get into contention. They get jealous. Then they start sowing discord among the brethren. They dissatisfied. And so now they're going to cause a whole a segment of the community to get dissatisfied. And so this is what happened to Korah. He came against Aaron and Moses. And so Korah gathered all the congregation against them. So he started sowing discord among the brethren. In Proverbs chapter 6, it says the Bible hates six things. And one of them was what? Sowing discord among the brethren. We still have people doing that today. At least the thing about Korah and all these people, they weren't saved. They weren't filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking with other tongues. But yet today we still have believers doing what? Sowing discord among the brethren. The Bible says that the scriptures are written for our admonition and our learning. The Bible says we have a better covenant established on better promises. And so because of that, absolutely, we should never participate in this kind of foolishness. That's what it really is. It spawned from the very pit of hell. Because you dissatisfied, and then you're going to make somebody else dissatisfied with something they don't even know about. Duh. It happens. And so this is what was going on here. And you're going to see how he dealt with it. He does not like that. And so they rose against his leader, his man of God. God gave Moses that assignment. And so here, Korah them, they decided, they began to speak against Moses as well as Aaron. And so in let me go to my scripture here first. So in verse 42, let's look at verse 42. Let's start with verse 41. He says, but on the morrow, so they go through all of this, and he says, but on the morrow, all the congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron, saying, you have killed the people of God. So what happened was, let me back up. What happened was, he said, okay, everybody get away from Korah and Daphne. There were three of them. Get away from their tents because I'm going to bring judgment against them. And so Moses told the congregation, get away from them because they were the ones who started all of this. And they're saying, well, we're just as good as you. Why can't we have these priestly duties? Does that sound familiar? No different than 2,000, 4,000 years later. And so God was just fed up. And so what happened was, so Moses says, okay, if they die a natural death, then God didn't speak to me. But if their death is uncommon, you know that God is backing us up. Well, the death was uncommon because what happened? The ground opened up and swallowed what? The whole family. Now, you would have thought that having seen that demonstration of God's wrath, that these fools would have known better not to keep complaining. But you think they did? Absolutely not. So, Over here, it says, let's start at verse 35. Well, no, I'm going to have to start at verse 31. It's, and it came to pass, start at verse 31. I'm still in Numbers chapter 16. And it came to pass, as he had made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground clave asunder that was under them. So that's talking about Korah and his group. Be careful who you follow. Remember, the Bible does say evil communications corrupt good manners or good character. You have to be very watchful of who you hang around with. I never will forget this. When I was in college, I had this roommate. And, you know, I guess my room, I don't know what she was doing, but she was doing something. But because I was hanging around with her, they thought that I was participating in the same thing. Totally innocent. Evil communications corrupt good manners. You have to teach your children who to hang out with. You cannot let your children hang out with anybody. Number one, for their safety. In the 21st century, you can't afford to allow your, oh Lord, let me get on that. Your sons and your daughters, especially your sons. You think your sons can hang out, your teenagers, 12, 13, 14, I'm driving home, they're out hanging out 10 o'clock at night. Why are they out in the street? Why are they not home supervised? God doesn't have double standards. That was one thing I love about the Bible. When I came to the Bible, I saw that God had the same standards for men that they had for women. People used to say dumb stuff. Well, you know, a man, he got to have another woman. He can't be faithful. That's the last spawn from the pit of hell. That's a big lie. And we bind that spirit in the name of Jesus in the body of Christ. He will and can be faithful. I don't know where they get that foolishness from. Sure, not in the Bible. But my point is that the same standards that you have for your daughters, you need to have for your son, and especially more not for your sons, because they're the ones that are out in the streets. They're the ones that participate in gangs. They're the ones that wear their, just this evening, this boy got his pants down here. I was in the car, but Lord, I wanted to get out. That's foolishness. He doesn't know who he is. We got to teach them who they are. They're not supposed to be conformed to this world. They're believers. I used to tell my daughter when I said, you represent two people. You represent Jesus and you represent me. I said, and me they can see. So you watch your behavior. You don't do everything everybody else does. So anyway, where did I leave off? Woo, praise you, Jesus. My. Yeah, so word to the wise is sufficient. Those of you who have sons, they have the same standards of holiness. You want your daughters to be virgins? Well, your daughter deserves a virgin son. Now, see, that's so strange to even Christian ears. But that's the truth. This is one of my pet peeves. I'm saying no. I don't see nowhere in that Bible about double standards. And I think I shared this before. I mean, my father, godly man, but he was going to make sure that we were all virgins. But he tells my brother, "Don't you get no girl pregnant?" You know what that said to my teenage 14, 15 year ears? Oh, it's okay for him to have sex. Just don't get nobody pregnant. That's double standard. No, you tell him to keep his legs crossed, pants zipped, just like you told the girls. But see, this teaching is unheard of even in the church today. Because I hear, I mean, well known, they talk about, my daughters, they all were virgins when they got married. And I'm thinking, well, you ain't saying that about your son. You ain't saying that about your son. You bragging about your daughters, but what about your sons? Because he's out there violating somebody else's daughter. You don't want your daughter violated. And that's what used to bug me with these men who would go with these young girls. But when you get a daughter, you holding her like a... But you done violated somebody else's daughter. Jesus does say, do unto others as you have them do unto you. You don't want nobody violating your daughter. How dare you go and violate somebody else's? Now, I had no... This is not in my notes. I don't know where this came from, but I know where it came from, but I had not planned to say this, but God wanted somebody to hear this. Because it's time for the church to be the church. Remember that sermon I taught? It's time for us to step up and be the church. Stop conforming to the world standard when it comes to certain things. The Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed. You have to transform, complete metamorphosis. You have to transform your thinking. Because we're bombarded with television and with all kinds of teachings and doctrines and opinions. And nobody's opinion matters but God's. Nobody's opinion matters but God. So I'm believing that we're going to hear more. Oh, yeah, my son is a virgin, too. I know it didn't go over too well, but I don't care. I'm going to teach it like he give it to me because I think it's right. She was teaching about righteousness. Righteousness is doing what is right. It's right to do it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah to Jesus. So where did I leave off? Okay, so verse what? So 41. So, but on the morrow, all the congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron, saying, you have killed the people of God. So they blaming Moses and Aaron, saying they killed the people. And it came to pass when the congregation was gathered against Moses and against Aaron that they looked toward the tabernacle of the congregation, and behold, the cloud, which represents the Holy Spirit, covered it, and the glory, God's manifest presence of the Lord, appeared. And Moses and Aaron came before the tabernacle of the congregation. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, get you up from among this congregation, that I may consume them as in a moment. And they fell on their faces. Moses, they fell on faith. They began to intercede. We were doing intercessory prayer earlier, standing in the gap. He says, and they fell upon their faces. And Moses said unto Aaron, take a censer and put fire therein from off the altar, and put on incense, and go quickly unto the congregation, and make an atonement for them. For there is wrath gone out from the Lord, and the plague is begun. They were complaining. Come against the man of God. Come against the high priest. And Aaron took as Moses commanded, and ran into the midst of the congregation, and behold, the plague was begun among the people, and he put on incense and made an atonement for the people. And he stood between the dead and the living, and the plague was stayed, or it was stopped. Now they that died in the plague were 14,700, beside them that died about the matter of Korah. And all this is because of their rebellious spirit. They brought it on themselves. And Aaron returned unto Moses, unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and the plague was stayed. Now let's go right into the chapter I want to get to, verse 7, chapter 17. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and take of every one of them a rod, according to the house of their fathers, of all their princes, according to the house of their fathers, 12 rods. What does the 12 rods represent? 12 tribes of Israel, exactly. And thou shalt write Aaron's name upon the rod of Levi. Because why is he writing Levi on Aaron's rod? Because what? Because he was from the what? The tribe of Levi. For one rod shall be for the head of the house of their father. And thou shalt lay them up in the tabernacle of the congregation before the testimony where I will meet with you. And it shall come to pass that the man's rod whom I shall choose, the man's rod whom I shall choose shall blossom, and I will make to cease from me the murmurings of the children of Israel whereby they murmur against you. I am going to demonstrate who I have authorized to have this position. Because what Corbin was doing, why are you the high priest? And so he's backing up the house of Levi. So he says here, he says, and Moses spake unto the children of Israel, and I'm reading verse 6, and every one of their princes gave him a rod apiece for each prince, one according to their father's houses, and 12 rods. And the rod of Aaron was among their rods. And Moses laid up the rods before the Lord in the tabernacle of a witness or as a testimony. So he says, and it came to pass that on the morrow, Moses went into the tabernacle of witness or testimony, and behold, looked upon the rod of Aaron for the house of Levi, what? Was budded and brought forth buds and bloomed blossoms and yielded almonds. And Moses brought out all the rods from before the Lord unto all the children of Israel, and they looked and took every man his rod. And the Lord said unto Moses, bring Aaron's rod again before the testimony to be kept for a token against the rebels. So God demonstrated that Aaron, who was from the tribe of Levi, that he had been authorized, solidified to operate as the high priest of Israel. And that rod, that blossom, as I told you before, it was a type of Christ's resurrection because it brought forth what? Life. Jesus Christ brought forth us what? Life. Amen? Amen. All right. Let's go to Romans chapter 6. We're talking about I am, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. So let's go to Romans chapter 6 real quick. And we're going to read verse 5 when you get there. Romans chapter 6, verse 5. Let's see. Yeah, I did have some notes here. Hold on. Okay, can you start reading for me for time's sake? And then I can get my little notes out here. Read it for me, please. Yes, verse 5, just verse 5. So he says that we've been planted. That word planted means grown along with. It means closely united to. It means experiencing the likeness of Christ's death. So he says, if we've been planted together in his likeness, in his similitude, This stresses on the outward similarities with nothing being considered about the inward similarities. He says, here that we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his what? So we have been, we say we are risen with Christ Jesus. What does that mean? That means that what? Death has no toll over us. Darkness has no toll over us. Because what? We've been given what? Life. Amen? All right, let's go to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians. Now, what do I have, about 5 minutes? Yeah, thank you. Okay. Philippians chapter 3. Are you there?
Yes.
Okay, so let me get there. So he says here in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, the Apostle Paul says, that I may know him. See, a lot of people, even believers, know about Jesus, but they don't, what? Know him. Paul says that I may know him. That word know means to have complete understanding of, to have understanding, have knowledge of, to recognize, to perceive, to know absolutely. You'd be surprised the number of people that don't know Jesus as believers. I was one of those. 30-some years ago, I just knew that he died on the cross for me. But you too, when he says, I want to know him, he says, I want to know him in the power, the demonstration, miracle working power of his resurrection. I want to understand what his resurrection did for me. He says, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship. I had no fellowship with Christ for all those years. Fellowship means intimacy, means participation, it means partnership. That's why just not enough of people to say words. Well, yeah, I accept Jesus Lord as Lord and Savior. That's why that scripture still bothers me, because people, Jesus says, you call me Lord, but I never knew you. He didn't know him on that level. If you're not praying, which I wasn't praying, I wasn't reading my Bible. So I had no relationship. I would pray the Lord's Prayer every time I thought about it, but I didn't even know how to pray. Why? Because we weren't taught how to pray the word. You'd pray the word. That's how you get results. Not making a lot of stuff that's not scriptural. You pray scriptures. That's the one thing I learned when about petition prayer. Is you pray the word. So when he says, I never knew you, he's saying, I'm not acquainted with you. You haven't spent any time with me for me to know who you are. There was a song they used to sing, I miss my time with you. You remember that? Yeah. Oh, that's so beautiful. And that's what he's saying to you and me. I miss, and we don't do it as an obligation. We do it as a motive of love. I spend time with him, not because I love him, not because, I'm not being religious. You know, I got to do, you know, 4 prayers today. If I do 4, fine. If I do 1, fine. But it's that intimacy, that's what's important. That he's talking to me while I'm listening. Because most of the time we do all the talking when we pray. Rarely are we listening. We all need to work on what? Listening more. Remember we talked about the good shepherd? That you know the voice of the good shepherd, and the voice of a stranger you will not follow. Remember that? Yeah. Amen. So it's important Paul is saying that I want to know him in the power. That's how I want to know him in the power and the dunamis, the miracle working power of his resurrection. So, church, let's get busy. Yes, we're expecting, I'm expecting the Lord to come, but he said occupy. That don't mean sit up and do nothing. That means increase our prayer time, increase our study time, increase our witnessing time. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm sure I've gone over those 5 minutes. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we just give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. We just thank you for your word. We thank you that, we want to know him in the power of his resurrection. Father, we be conformed to his image. That's what you purpose us to do. That's what you predestined, yea, even before the foundations of the world, that we would be predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. That we would be little Jesus walking around with that light dispelling darkness wherever we go. And so, Father, if we haven't been doing our job, I repent for us as a body of Christ and myself individually. So, Father, we just thank you that we're going from glory to glory to glory, and that we will see the salvation of the Lord in the lives of the people that you lead us to and that we come in contact with. And so we just love you. We appreciate you. We just give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, praise the Lord. Well, we don't have
salvation is the free gift that the Lord offers anyone who would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10 that with our hearts we believe unto righteousness, and with our mouth confession is made unto salvation. I trust that you will believe God's word, that your faith will be in the risen Savior who came to give his life for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Will you pray with me this prayer of salvation? It's not difficult. It's very easy, but you must mean it from your heart. So repeat these words after me. Jesus, I confess you as my Savior and my Lord. I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I confess you, and I receive you as my Savior. Jesus, thank you for making my heart your home. Thank you for living in me. God the Father is now my Father, and the Holy Spirit has done a work in me. I am a new creature in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me, and thank you for guiding my life. In Jesus' name, amen. We're here to be a blessing to you at Spirit Food Christian Center. The way this broadcast is brought to you is by people's faithful sowing and reaping as a result of God's word being given unto them. So I want to encourage you, be a part of this ministry of sowing and reaping. The Bible says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In this ministry, we believe that man must hear the word of God. For man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The Bible declares, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. God loves a cheerful and hilarious giver. I encourage you, be a part of this ministry. Be hilarious in your giving, and watch the Lord bring it back to you in many, many ways. In Jesus' name.
You have been watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast online at www.myspiritfood.com. Join us for worship service each Sunday at 9:30 a.m. And be sure to check out our website for our weekly live broadcast and much, much more. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.